Hello students, good afternoon and welcome to my channel Learn English. Today we begin with a new poem which is Nose versus Eyes by William Cowper. So the poem Nose versus Eyes is a poem written by William Cowper. It is about a disagreement between two principal characters of the poem, the nose and the eyes. So both the nose and the eyes are claiming their sole right over the ownership of spectacles. Precisely, they want a clear decision on their claim. Therefore, it is very evident from the title that the title is about a dispute between two characters, that is, nose and eyes, by using the word versus. So, let's see what this poem is all about. It seems to be an interesting poem, and let's see who wins at the end. Icebreakers. Complete the verb with the help of adjectives used to describe eyes and nose in all respects. Two have been done for you. First, to understand what are adjectives, we need to know what are nouns. So I'm sure everybody knows what are nouns. So something that describes a noun is called as a adjective. For example, eyes. Eyes is a noun. Now if you have to describe the eyes, how is the eyes looking? Is it big? Is it beautiful? Is it black in color? Is it deep? All these that describe or tell us more about the noun, that is eyes, is called as an adjective. Similarly, nose. How is the nose? Is it pointy? Is it sharp? Is it long? Is it powerful? Is it sensitive? All these describing the word nose is called as the adjective. So remember, adjective always describes a noun. Now this poem is about the nose and the eyes, which is taken to the court, and therefore we need to understand some legal terminology which is used in court affairs. Let us discuss that in detail. What do you mean by affidavit? Affidavit is a written statement or a document confirmed by oath or affirmation for use as evidence in court. So an affidavit is a written statement which has an affirmation or a stamp which can be used in court as evidence. What do you mean by an argument? A series of reasons given for or against a matter under decision intended to convince the listener is called as an argument. A consent is a voluntary agreement to the proposal. Counsel is a person who gives advice on legal matters. Judgment is the decision of the court to solve a controversy and determination of the rights and obligation of the parties concerned. Trial. A judicial examination and determination of facts and legal issues arising between parties to a civil or a criminal action. Verdict. The formal decision issued by a jury on matters submitted to the jury by the judge. Contempt of court. Offense of being disobedient or disrespectful to a court of law. Notice. Information usually in writing in all legal proceedings. Stay order. The act of temporarily stopping a judicial proceeding through the order of court is called as a stay order. So the answers are given on this slide. You can have a look at them. Let's move forward. Name the five sensory organs and provide phrases, idioms, proverb related to them. One has been done for you. So what are the five sensory organs? Let us discuss that first. So what do you mean by sense organs? Sense organs are sense of sight, that is your ear, your eyes, sense of hearing, your ears, sense of smell, nose, sense of taste, that is through your tongue, and sense of touch through your skin. So these are the five sensory organs, and the five senses are sight, hearing, smell, touch and taste. Let's discuss the idioms now. To turn a deaf ear means to refuse to listen. To lend a ear means to listen. So I am all ears when the teacher is teaching in the online class. So which means you have an inclination, you need to listen to the teacher. Next, beauty lies in the eyes of a beholder. What do you mean by that? Different people will have different opinion on you. Pay through your nose. If somebody says that I have paid through my nose, it means they have paid a lot of money. Do not copy right under my nose, which means directly in front of someone, do not do any wrong or right things. Tongue in cheek, which means not serious. Bite your tongue, which means to take back something that you have said. Hand in glove, which means working together, often to do something dishonest. Put your finger on something, which means to find out something correctly. A thick skin, which means availability to ignore criticism. So these are few of the phrases, idioms and proverbs discussed. There are few more examples which is written on the slide. You all can go through the same. Nose versus eyes is written and composed by William Cowper, who was one of the most popular poets in the 18th century. Samuel T. Coleridge even quoted him to be one of the best modern poets of his times. He used to write poems on nature and everyday life. He also composed a lot of hymns for the church. Though he studied jurisprudence, which means law, he admitted that he was not inclined to the legal profession. Nose versus eyes is a satire on the judiciary system. It mocks at the stone-blind justice in a humorous manner, emphasizing upon the lack of empathy and common sense. Let's see what the poem is all about. Let's discuss the summary of the lesson, Nose versus Eyes. As discussed in the introduction, this is a dispute between two prominent characters in the poem, which is the nose and the eyes. And both are claiming the ownership of the spectacles. So therefore, this matter reaches the court and the tongue is the lawyer. So the tongue argues the case for the nose and he favors the nose, claiming that the nose has been used to wearing the spectacles from time immemorial. He made valid points and stronger points by physically displaying to the judge various parts of the spectacles which fitted the nose perfectly. His last argument was more powerful than all the other logic he had put forward. He said with a lot of confidence that if nose was not there on the face, wearing the spectacles would have been almost impossible. And he concluded that the spectacles and the nose were made for each other. But surprisingly, the same lawyer, that is tongue, shifted to the other side to defend the second applicant. Who was the second applicant? Yes, the eyes. But even with so much of proficiency in language, he could not convince the judge or anybody else in the courtroom. They were so ambiguous that the judge had to declare him unwise. Thus, the official order from the judge was announced very clearly and decisively in favor of the nose. Not only that, the eyes were instructed to be shut whenever the nose wore the spectacles. So the poem is actually a satire. Satire means it is a sarcastic poem on the judicial system, hinting at blind justice. The presentation was so humorous that the readers enjoy it, even if it discusses a serious matter like providing impartial treatment to the deserving claimant. So So let's see, we will read the poem and see how nose is better than eyes. Nose versus Eyes by William Cowper. The first stanza. Between nose and eyes, a strange contest arose. The spectacle set them unhappily wrong. The point in dispute was, as all the world knows, to which the said spectacles ought to belong. So the first stanza clearly says that there was a dispute, a disagreement, and the disagreement was on the spectacles. Whom does it belong? So there was a point of dispute, disagreement, and the world knew about it, and both the nose and the eyes wanted to know who does the spectacles actually belong to. The next stanza. So tongue was the lawyer and argued the cause with great deal of skill and a wig full of learning. A wig full of learning. Wig, we all know that it is a special covering, which means artificial hair worn by judges. So the tongue, a lawyer. What does a lawyer need to have? A lot of intelligence, a lot of knowledge. So the tongue was the lawyer and he argued the case. And why did he argue the case? Because he had a great deal of skill and he had a great deal of knowledge as well. While Chief Baron here sat to balance the laws. So Fab for his talent is nicely discerning. So Chief Baron here is a powerful person, which means he was the judge. And he sat there in front of the court nicely discerning, which means to show his good judgment. He did not want to be partial. In behalf of the nose, it will quickly appear. And your lordship, he said, with undoubtedly find that the nose has had spectacles always in wear. So tongue says the nose always had the spectacles, and because of the nose, the spectacles could fit properly on the face, which amounts to position time out of mind, which becomes to position time out of mind, which means the position of the spectacle is clearly given to the nose. Then holding the spectacles up to the court, your lordship observes they are made with a straddle. Straddle means it extends across both the sides, as wide as the ridge of the nose is. In short, designed to sit close to it, just like a saddle. A saddle means a low part of the ridge between two high points, sit with a raised ridge. Okay, so he's holding the spectacles to the court and he says that, lordship, please observe, it is made with a straddle, which means it is made extending both the sides and as wide as the ridge on the edge of the nose. It sits on the edge of the nose. In short, it sits close to it just like a saddle. Again, would your lordship a moment suppose this a case that has happened and maybe again, that the visage and countenance had not a nose? Pray who would or who could wear spectacles then? So now he tells the audience and all the other members and also the judge that what if people didn't have a nose? Pray that if the nose was not there, where would the spectacles sit? Visage and countenance means the face. That the face had not a nose, then we don't know what could have been done. There was no use of a spectacles then. He continues his argument and says, on the whole it appears, and my argument shows, with a reasoning the court will never condemn, which means will never express disapproval, that the spectacles plainly were made for the nose, which means now he's saying that the spectacle belongs only to the nose, and the nose was a plainly intended for them. Okay, so spectacles was made for the nose and vice versa. Then what does he do? He quickly shifts his side because he wants to plead on behalf of the eyes as well. Then shifting his side as a lawyer knows how, he pleaded again on behalf of the eyes, in behalf of the eyes. But what were his arguments? Few people know. for the court did not think they were equally wise. Now, as he was pleading for the eyes as well, but the court did not find his judgment as supportive as that of the nose. So his lordship decreed with a grave, solemn tone. Decreed means an official order that had the force of law. So his lordship decreed with a great formal tone, decisive and clear without one if or but, that whenever the nose put his spectacles on by daylight or candlelight, eyes should be shut. So now the lordship heard both the sides of the argument, that of the nose and that of the eyes made by the tongue. However, he comes to a decision that the tongue has not made justice to the eyes, but has made full justice to the nose. And then he gives his official order in a very dignified manner and says that the spectacle belongs to the nose. And whenever a person puts on his spectacles over his nose and wears it, the eyes, be it daylight or candlelight, should be shut. So this takes us back to the system, the judicial system, where you can see that there is a blindfold on the lady whenever we go to a court, okay, which means it says justice is blind. So this is a sarcastic poem where the poet says, where the poet uses satire and talks about how justice is blind and how the claimant does not receive proper justice. Let's quickly do the brainstorming, students. Let's state whether the following statements are true or false. And if they are false, you need to correct them. So nose can use spectacles, true. Eyes have to be shut when nose wears or puts spectacles, yes, true. The ear was appointed as a judge, yes, true. So ear baron was appointed as a judge. Eyes cannot use spectacles, true. Eyes cannot use the spectacles, they have to be shut. Let's match the following expressions given in column A with the interpretations in column B. So while chief baron here sat to balance the law, the responsibility of giving verdict rested on the shoulders of the hearing organ. So here was EAR, here was responsible for giving the judgment. They are made with the straddle as wide as the ridge of the nose is, which means spectacles are meant for none other than the nose. That whenever the nose put his spectacles on by daylight or candlelight, eyes should be shut, which means eyes are refrained from using the spectacles, are stopped from using the spectacles. Last one. So his lordship decreed with a grave, solemn tone, decisive and clear, without one if or but, which means the judge delivered a firm verdict without any doubt. Without if and but means without any doubt. So the tongue, who was the lawyer, justifies the position of the spectacles on behalf of the nose first. So now what we need to do is we need to pick out the expressions from the poem that argue in favor of the nose, and you need to complete the Venn diagram, arguments in favor of the nose. So what does the tongue say in favor of the nose? He says that the nose has to wear spectacles always in wear, and they are made with a straddle, which means with two sides as wide as the ridge of the nose, and the visage and countenance, which means the face. If it didn't have a nose, what would happen? There would be no spectacles. Spectacles would have been useless. Comment on the following characters depicted in the poem in a sentence or a phrase. So on nose and on eyes. So on nose, the nose claims ownership of the spectacles. On the eyes, now since eyes was the was the other applicant. So because he was not having enough proof of ownership of spectacles, those spectacles belong to 8, eyes are on the verge of losing the case. Okay, because the case was not presented well by the tongue. Tongue was in favor, was actually fighting the case for both. However, his arguments for nose were much more powerful than that of the eye. And because of that, eyes was on the losing end. Pick out examples of inversion from the poem. So first, let us understand what do you mean by inversion. Inversion is a figure of speech, or also called as a literary device. Inversion refers to the reversal of the correct order of the sentence, which means because of poetic effect, the word order has been shuffled. Okay, and actually the word order has to be something else. For example, yesterday I saw a ship. An inversion of the sentence could be, I saw a ship yesterday. Okay, so let us pick out examples of inversion from the poem. Between nose and eyes, a strange contest arose. Okay, a strange contest arose between the nose and eyes is the correct sentence. That doesn't mean this sentence is wrong. This sentence is written in a particular way, which is an inverted manner for poetic effect. Okay, so the correct order of the sentence. Now, if this comes in the exam, pick out inversion and tell me why it is inversion. So you could say, between nose and eyes, a strange contest arose is an example of inversion. Why? Because the order of the sentence has been changed or has been jumbled for poetic effect. The correct order of the sentence is, a strange contest arose between nose and eyes. So you will tell me what is inversion, why it is inversion, and what is the correct sentence. Then you get the marks. In behalf of the nose, it will quickly appear. What is the correct order of the sentence? It will quickly appear on behalf of the nose. Why is this an inversion? Because the sentence or the words has been jumbled for poetic effect. Now the verdict was that the nose and the spectacles belong to each other. Now we have to justify that, and you have to support the answer with the help of the suitable arguments. So what are the arguments? The tongue says the nose always wears the spectacles. The spectacles are designed to sit close to the nose, and it is impossible to wear spectacles without resting on the nose. And that is why the verdict was given to the nose and not the eyes. Compose two lines of your own on any sensory organ. So any sensory organ you can take and compose a poem. For example, nose is so close to us, far fragrance it tells. Okay, any sensory organs. We have 5 sense organs. You can compose a poem on any. Imagine that you are a lawyer defending the case of eyes in court. Present your counter statement in support of your client. Now, if you were in place of the tongue and you were taking the side of the eyes, how would you present your case? So we could say that spectacles are made for the eyes rather than the nose. They protect the eyes from sunlight and dust. They also improve eyesight. Here, there is no use of the nose, and therefore the spectacle should belong to the eyes and no one else. Let's discuss the appreciation of the poem. Why do you like this poem? What in the poem do you appreciate? So this poem is called Nose versus Eyes. As discussed, it is a satirical poem on the judiciary system. It makes fun of blind justice and it emphasizes on the lack of empathy and common sense in judgment. The poem is humorous and satirical. The poet uses human organs as characters in the poem. He describes the fight between the eyes and the nose, and the dispute is over the ownership of spectacles. Ear is deputed to be the judge and tongue is deputed to be a lawyer to defend both the eyes and the nose. The first, he defends the nose. very cleverly in his argument, the ear is convinced and passes his judgment in favor of the nose because of his strong judgment and his strong points. The poet has used different figures of speech such as inversion, personification, simile, and metonymy. Metonymy means it is again a figure of speech or a figurative language in which a word is replaced by something very close to the original meaning. For example, instead of saying the king, I will say the crown. Or for example, instead of referring to a businessman as businessman, we usually use metonymy, which refer to them as suits. Okay, so the word suit is associated with businessman, as this is usually the style of clothes that businessmen wear. So the rhyme scheme of this poem is ABAB. The poem gives close resemblance to the human life. The images in the poem describes human tendency. People believe in hearsay rather than truth. So this is the appreciation of the poem that needs to be followed whenever you are writing your answer paper. So William Shakespeare has a very important role when he says, or when he's written this idiom or phrase which says, "Lend thy ears to all, but few thy tongue." What does this mean? This is a famous quote by William Shakespeare. And what does this mean? So the quote, "Lend thy ears to all." Let everybody listen to what? You must listen to what everybody is saying, but few thy tongue. Suggests that while one must be quick to listen to others' opinions or views, give your opinion to others very cautiously. Think before you speak. This is because listening to a variety of options and views help to form a clear perspective. However, when giving out an opinion, careful consideration and thought must be given to the matter at hand, and only one is sure of their viewpoint should one venture to speak. If you are clear and if you are absolutely 100% sure of your decision, that's when you will speak and talk about your decision to the opposite person. So this brings us to the end of our poem, Nose versus Eyes. Question answers will be shared on the group. Request you to please complete your assignment on time.